Hello and welcome to a special bonus episode of the Weekly Stuff podcast. I'm Jonathan Lack, and today we're doing something a little different. A few weeks ago on the show, I teased that I was working on a paper for my PhD program about Star Wars, and specifically the weird, disturbing relationship to nostalgia in the sequel trilogy. The paper was actually informed quite a bit by the discussion Sean and I had about the Rise of Skywalker back on episode 309, and other Star Wars conversations we've had over the years. When I put a few excerpts on Twitter while I was writing, several listeners very kindly asked if they could read the full thing when it was done. So to make the paper as accessible as possible, I've gone ahead and recorded a reading of the entire thing, which is what you will hear today. It's about the recent Star Wars sequel films and this entire trend of 30-year-later legacy sequels in general. Now, this is an academic paper, not a typical review or online think piece, but I think you'll enjoy it if you're interested in the topic. And for those of you who would like to read the actual text for themselves, I've gone ahead and put a link to the PDF in the show notes of this episode. You can also, of course, see all of the footnotes and citations there that aren't present in the audio version. So without further ado, let's go ahead and get started. Who's your space daddy? Star Wars, fantasy parents, and nostalgic tethers in 21st century legacy sequels. By Jonathan R. Lack. He who dies with the most toys wins. Malcolm Forbes. At the climax of Return of the Jedi, the final chapter of George Lucas's original Star Wars saga, Luke Skywalker lays down his lightsaber. It is a radical act of pacifism, one which finally turns his father Darth Vader back to the light, allowing for the defeat of Emperor Palpatine and the long-prophesied balancing of the Force. For the first time in thousands of years, the standard-bearer of the Jedi Order is not a hypocrite, choosing to live up to the highest ideals of the Jedi at the ultimate moment of challenge, rather than compromise them for immediate gain. And for the first time in centuries of scheming, Darth Sidious is presented with a situation he cannot predict, and therefore cannot manipulate, because Skywalker has done something that goes against his understanding of his enemy's flaws. Thus the Sith are defeated, because a Jedi chooses to let go of tradition, and do what he knows in his heart is right. At the climax of The Rise of Skywalker, the final chapter of Disney's 30 years later sequel trilogy, Rey picks up a second lightsaber. Struggling against her grandfather Palpatine, miraculously revived without explanation, she hears the voices of all the Jedi throughout the franchise, stressing the importance of their legacy and how it has been entrusted to her. "Every Jedi who ever lived lives in you," says the voice of Qui-Gon Jinn. Emboldened, she fights back against Grandpa's Force lightning, first with one lightsaber. "I am all the Sith," sneers her space granddad, seemingly getting the upper hand. "And I am all the Jedi," Rey retorts, summoning a second lightsaber with the Force, crossing the two blades in front of her, and using their power to do exactly what her wicked grandpappy wanted her to do all along, and what Luke Skywalker once avoided by tossing his blade aside. She forces his lightning back upon him and strikes the Emperor down in fury. Imbued with legacy and history, trusted to keep a tradition alive, Rey does exactly what Gramps wanted, because she is told she is special, that the Jedi are a perfect goal to which one aspires, that lightsabers are cool and righteous, and that believing in all these things hard enough, rather than questioning what one is taught and trying to grow beyond it, is the ultimate path to victory. Perhaps no moment in the blockbuster cinema of the 2010s is more emblematic of American mass media's fixation on nostalgia, not just as a tool for commerce or a fun wink and a nod, but as a way tentpole films confer subjectivity to their core fan base by reassuring viewers that their lifelong obsessions are not only valid, but of paramount importance. Disney's Star Wars sequel films demonstrate, not only through the nostalgia-fueled J.J. Abrams entries that bookend the trilogy, but also through the stark counterpoint offered by Rian Johnson's middle chapter, The Last Jedi, which sparked legions of online trolls into action. A trend in popular cinema from the last decade to render viewers not merely consumers, but children. Children in need of reassurance and affirmation, living in a space where fantasy reigns supreme. Like Peter Pan and the Lost Boys, they never have to grow up, are able to claim any figure one wants as their parents and guardians, never responsible for having to face or claim a larger or more complicated reality. At this point, after all, the formula of such films is well known. Literal or figurative children of cinematic forebearers, serving as protagonists in a decades later sequel, fulfilling a fantasy for an audience either hungry for nostalgia or conditioned to react to its sweet, comforting nectar. Dan Golding has termed these legacy films, and outlined an easily identifiable series of traits. The legacy character, the successor character, the revision of existing narrative concerns, the generational handoff, and the withering legacy, seen in films like Terminator Genesis, Jurassic World, 2009's Star Trek, Tron Legacy, and Creed. All Hollywood fantasies endeavor, on some level, to suture us into their world. To borrow from Kaja Silverman, they collapse the spoken subject, the viewer, with the subject of speech, the on-screen character, in ways that make us identify with the protagonist and feel some sense of shared experience with, and perhaps ownership of, their on-screen adventure. This is, of course, a basic tenet of narrative fiction with deep literary roots, such as the way Robert Louis Stevenson's Treasure Island is written as a first-person record of the fantastic adventure of a boy the same age as the intended reader. What the legacy film adds, to build on the psychoanalytic work of Salman Akhtar, is the fantasy of a tether, the creation of a confining orbit within which the viewer feels safe, interacting with suturing subjectivity in a way that ties us into that world such that our nostalgic fantasies are comforted, reassured, and endorsed, and which, to an audience either expectant of or conditioned to trust in that tether, can be extremely threatening when broken. Nowhere is this more apparent than in the Star Wars sequel trilogy. The original films by George Lucas operate on the basic level of Hollywood fantasy identification, with a seemingly ordinary everyman or every boy protagonist Luke Skywalker, who gets to go on a mysterious adventure of discovery. The sequel trilogy, on the other hand, is emblematic of the ways we are not sutured in for an unknown adventure, but for a very specific adventure, a Star Wars adventure, codified for an audience primed to know what that means. Daisy Ridley's Rey is not an every man or every girl, but a Star Wars fangirl who gets to go on a stereotypical Star Wars adventure, as viewers in the audience wish they could, and she is tethered to this world by legacy characters like Luke, Han Solo, and Leia Organa, who collectively become her space parents. She gets to go from obscurity to part of this space family, and even learns she has special, royal, powerful blood, meaning she is not just adopted into that family, but meant to be there, the tether growing stronger every step along the way. Who, these films ask, is your space daddy? The desire to have the film and its world become one's family, one's parent, one's authority figure, mentor, and safety blanket is coded into these films every step of the way. Rey gets to claim almost every major adult figure from the original trilogy as her space daddy or space mommy at one point or another, not just limited to heroes like Luke, Han, Leia, and Lando Calrissian, but also the villains like Emperor Palpatine and Darth Vader. Johnson's The Last Jedi is the exception that proves the rule, as it strives to question and even disrupt the tether, with Luke Skywalker portrayed as a distant space daddy, who disciplines and refuses to dote upon his figurative child, who tells the child other children should get to come play in the toy chest, or most radically, that perhaps the child should grow up and leave the toy chest behind entirely. The film's real-world reception in bitter fan communities, incensed over Johnson questioning the strength or validity of their precious tether, perfectly mirrors the clinical anxieties Akhtar describes in patients fearful of losing their own tethers. The Rise of Skywalker, then, works overtime to restore and fortify that tether, even at the cost of all narrative logic and cohesion. It slaps the prior film's assertions down as hard as possible. Nobody else gets to play in the toy chest. One must have special blood to access the toy chest, and living within that toy chest is the only meaningful existence. Its orbit must never be left. Getting more toys, the most toys, as in Rey defeating Palpatine by getting two lightsabers instead of one, is what will make you the victor, the strongest, the best. In this film, Space Daddy Luke apologizes for ever being hard on you, and admits he was wrong to ever take the toy away. He's a good Space Daddy now. Part 1. On May 9th, 2020, a clip went viral on Twitter featuring Dave Filoni, creator and general director of the Star Wars The Clone Wars, Star Wars Rebels, and Star Wars Resistance animated TV series, and one of the key creative bridges from the George Lucas era of Star Wars to the Disney one. In the clip, he gives a passionate, erudite analysis of the climactic lightsaber duel between Qui-Gon Jinn, Obi-Wan Kenobi, and Darth Maul from The Phantom Menace.
What's at stake is really how Anakin's going to turn out, because Qui-Gon is different than the rest of the Jedi, and you get that in the movie, and Qui-Gon is fighting because he knows he's the father that Anakin needs, because Qui-Gon hasn't given up on the fact that Jedi are supposed to actually care and love, and that that's not a bad thing. The rest of the Jedi are so detached, and they've become so political that they've really lost their way, and Yoda starts to see that in the second film, but Qui-Gon is ahead of them all. And that's why he's not part of the council. So he's fighting for Anakin. And that's why it's the duel of the fates. It's the fate of this child. And depending on how this fight goes, Anakin is going to, his life is going to be dramatically different. So Qui-Gon loses, of course. So the father figure, because he knew what it meant to take this kid away from his mother when he had an attachment, and he's left with Obi-Wan. Obi-Wan trains Anakin at first out of a promise he makes to Qui-Gon, not because he cares about him. When they get Anakin, when they find him on Tatooine, he says, why do I feel like we've found another useless life form? He's comparing Anakin to Jar Jar.
Excuse me.
And he's saying, this is a waste of our time. Why are we doing this? Why do you see importance in these creatures like Jar Jar Binks and this 10-year-old boy? This is useless. So he's a brother to Anakin eventually, but he's not a father figure. Mm. That's a failing for Anakin. He doesn't have the family that he needs. He loses his mother in the next film. He fails on this promise that he made, mother, I will come back and save you. So he's left completely vulnerable. And Star Wars ultimately is about family. So that moment in that movie, which a lot of people I think diminish into just, oh, it's just a cool lightsaber fight, but it's everything that the entire three films of the prequels hangs on, is that one particular fight.
Taken from a recent episode of Disney Gallery, Star Wars The Mandalorian, a behind-the-scenes series on streaming platform Disney Plus featuring key creatives from the 2019 live-action show, the clip was first shared by Star Wars fan account A Galaxy United, who presented the clip with the words, "This is why Dave Filoni is the GOAT," referring to the acronym GOAT, or Greatest of All Time. Their tweet garnered 1,000 retweets and over 3,000 likes at the time of this writing, and the clip was subsequently picked up by bigger outlets like Culture Crave, where it got another 3,400 retweets and 15,400 likes. For a few days, it was glowingly passed around film Twitter, one of the only times in living memory the Star Wars prequel trilogy has been discussed positively on the internet in any sustained fashion. Filoni's analysis did not strike a chord because it was a groundbreaking act of film criticism. For the most part, Filoni is just clearly and thoughtfully reading the text of The Phantom Menace in relation to the rest of Lucas's saga. His interpretation is very smart and thematically trenchant, but the act of approaching film this way is in and of itself hardly revelatory. What made the clip seem radical is how, in the 20 years since The Phantom Menace was released, so few people have deigned to do this for these particular films. Filoni's analysis is predicated first on taking George Lucas's prequel trilogy seriously, and then on understanding that those films are in fact critical of the Jedi Order and its myriad hypocrisies, which is what makes Qui-Gon Jinn and his pure idealism stand out, and which dooms Anakin Skywalker to his dark fate when he is left to a Jedi Order without Qui-Gon in it. Yet this foundational theme of the prequels is perhaps the core element of the films that has made fans and media refuse to engage with their text for over two decades. The films are, at their heart, critical of the order we believed were magical and perfect when we were children. The Jedi existed in our imaginations when watching Luke Skywalker's adventures from the 70s and 80s, because they were, of course, mostly gone by the time Luke started his journey. One of the key reasons to anticipate the prequels was to see the Jedi in their heyday, and the intentional subversion of this trilogy lies in showing a Jedi Order that is creaky, complacent, and too set in its ways to see the danger at its doorstep. The prequels are, collectively, a message against the kinds of blind hero worship that saturate 21st century blockbuster filmmaking. They are not a story about a group of superheroes who come together despite adversity and emerge triumphant, but a dark parable about a special organization imbued with great power, whose failings lead to their own collective downfall, the destruction of galactic democracy, and the mutilation of one of their most promising heroes into a villain of untold destructive might. And the bottom line is that while the prequels are far from perfect and have legitimate filmmaking issues to criticize, their problems are not, in and of themselves, so unique and off-putting to warrant the reputation they have earned. I would posit that the 20-year hate campaign against the prequel trilogy comes from a much deeper-seated resistance to the uncomfortable ideas they put forward, a cognitive dissonance between fans thinking Star Wars is one narrow thing, being told by the man who created it that it's actually a much broader and more thematically complex thing, and collectively losing their minds, rather than try to put in the critical thought necessary to rectify those positions. Suffice it to say, one of the main lessons Hollywood, Disney, and J.J. Abrams had undeniably learned by the time The Force Awakens came around in 2015 was that coddling fans was much easier than challenging them. As Dan Golding writes in his 2019 book Star Wars After Lucas, The Force Awakens is very clearly a film about handing over the baton in a way that A New Hope, or any other Star Wars film, plainly is not. A film that establishes future heroes by rekindling and building on the past. It is a film about preserving and continuing the legacy of the past, rather than challenging or reconstituting it. Unlike the prequels, which intentionally complicate the romanticized image of pre-imperial times held by characters in, and fans of, the original trilogy, The Force Awakens posits its legacy as a treasure to be uncovered and brought back to life. Star Wars is not alone in this turn towards resurrecting the past. As Golding points out, quote, "A preoccupation with legacy has become one of the defining features of blockbuster sequels in recent years," end quote. Golding calls this new model of franchise continuation the legacy film, a series of works whose goal is to extend the life of a film series and renew it for a new era. He identifies five common elements shared amongst major examples. Original actors returning as aged versions of their characters. New successor characters primed to take up the mantle of older characters, new narrative concerns that repeat and revise old narrative concerns, usually with legacy characters passing on specialized knowledge or skills that the audience is already familiar with, handover moments between legacy and successor characters where the torch is passed, either literally or symbolically, from one generation to the next, and a shift in narrative impetus from the legacy characters to their successors by the end of the film, often through the death, retirement, or sidelining of the legacy character. Golding cites a wide range of films featuring these five ingredients, mostly from the 2010s, but including some important precursors, like 1994's Star Trek Generations, the first Star Trek film featuring the cast of the Next Generation TV series, wherein a temporarily displaced Captain Kirk serves as a link between the two casts and ultimately passes the torch to Captain Jean-Luc Picard. J.J. Abrams himself helped to kick off the 2010s flood of legacy films with his 2009 Star Trek reboot, which features a new cast playing the original characters in an alternate timeline, where Leonard Nimoy's original Mr. Spock is inadvertently sent and there serves as the legacy character passing the torch to his new, younger successors. Golding's model is an excellent framing for identifying and understanding the major tenets of what has become a dominant subgenre in Hollywood franchise filmmaking. But there is more work to be done considering how and why these films pitch themselves to their audience, and what literary and cinematic traditions they are interacting with, and in some cases, tripping over, in reconstituting old stories for new generations. This is where we need to consider the issue of identification, and how a legacy film like The Force Awakens confers its fantastical subjectivity in ways subtly but significantly different than its predecessors. One word I will use here as a form of shorthand for how films develop identification between audience and story is suture, a term defined by Kaja Silverman as, quote, "the name given to the procedures by means of which cinematic texts confer subjectivity upon their viewers." All forms of narrative art, including literature and cinema, create the illusion of narrative by asking us to identify our own subjectivity with that of the story's subject. Building on several prominent semioticians, Silverman outlines for us three subjects that are active when we read a novel or watch a film. The spoken subject is us, the viewer, the reader, the audience. The subject of speech is the fictional character with whom we are aligned. And the speaking subject is the apparatus through which this character communes, be it the pages of a book or the moving images of a film, all of which offer the subject enunciation. In everyday conversation, the speaking subject automatically connects up the pronouns I and you with those mental images by means of which it recognizes both itself and the person to whom it speaks, and it identifies with the former of these. But when reading a novel or watching a film, the subject performs only one of these actions, that of identification. The individual subjectivity of the spoken subject is partially sublimated by permitting a fictional character to stand in for it, or by allowing a particular point of view to define what it sees. The operation of suture is successful at the moment that viewing subject says, "Yes, that's me," or "That's what I see." The moment Silverman uses to represent suture in cinema is the shot-reverse-shot formulation, where a two-way conversation is represented by opposing camera placements that consciously reflect the lack of the spoken subject and, in so doing, invite the viewer to inhabit that role. But there are many possible suture points in cinema and in literature, and it can be as simple as starting a story in a way that puts us behind the eyes of the protagonist, and that makes their experience seem immediate to their intended audience. Take, for instance, the opening paragraph of Robert Louis Stevenson's Treasure Island. Squire Trelawney, Dr. Livesley, and the rest of these gentlemen, having asked me to write down the whole particulars about Treasure Island, from the beginning to the end, keeping nothing back but the bearings of the island, and that only because there is still treasure not yet lifted, I take up my pen in the year of Grace 17, and go back to the time when my father kept the Admiral Benbow Inn, and the brown old seaman with the saber cut first took up his lodging under our roof. Here, Stevenson directly establishes a first-person perspective from a protagonist who, while writing, is slightly older than the tale's intended audience of young or preteen boys, but whose adventure took place when he was their age. And throughout the opening section, as Jim's quiet life at the Admiral Benbow is gradually turned upside down by the presence of Billy Bones, we are asked to imagine ourselves in this situation, which seems quite relatable at first before becoming fantastic. George Lucas's original 1977 Star Wars does this too, establishing Luke Skywalker as a restless kid in a boring, monotonous life, who wants to go off and see more of the world outside. In both cases, the initial simplicity of the main character and relative normalcy of their surroundings creates space for the reader or viewer to be sutured into the narrative. It is a technique which belongs to a grand literary tradition, identified in 1949 by Joseph Campbell as the hero's journey, or monomyth, which refer to archetypal heroes and their adventures found in myths across the world. Treasure Island is, of course, a textbook example, paradigmatic of a brand of serial fiction aimed at boys that follow such an archetypal path. George Lucas very consciously revived it for Star Wars, building the plot closely around the tenets of Campbell's monomyth, and thus popularizing the structure all over again as a storytelling formula for Hollywood to employ. Star Wars checks just about every box on the list of hero's journey steps, starting with the establishment of the ordinary world, the aforementioned space within which we initially identify with the hero and are sutured into their point of view. It also features the call to adventure, Luke learning his father was a Jedi and being invited by Ben Kenobi to learn the ways of the Force, the refusal of the call, Luke returning home rather than travel with Ben, the acceptance of the call, Luke finding his aunt and uncle horrifically burned and choosing to train as a Jedi, the hero entering the unknown, traveling to new towns, worlds, and moon-sized battle stations, the presence of supernatural aid, Ben Kenobi and the Force, acquiring a talisman, the lightsaber, and the tests, or supreme ordeal at the end, which for Luke take the shape of leading the charge against the Death Star and learning to trust in the Force. The archetypal structure of the hero's journey is one of the oldest and most durable narrative formulas that confer subjectivity, particularly to a young, predominantly male audience. Even if we no longer or have never belonged to this group, the structure inherently endeavors to suture us into this point of view, making us feel some degree of ownership over the adventure as though it could be happening to us. While Lucas's own prequel films intentionally do not follow the archetypal monomyth, one of many ways in which they are structurally quite dissimilar from the original entries, Disney's sequel trilogy, by mirroring The Force Awakens so closely after A New Hope, is inevitably wedded to it. Yet when the structure of the monomyth is combined with the core elements of the legacy film, strange and critical differences come into play. For while Rey's journey follows many of the same organizing signposts as Luke's, or any of the many archetypal heroes that came before them, it is all framed a little differently. Rey's ordinary world is not particularly ordinary, because the idea of Star Wars itself already exists inside of it. In what feels like a dark, depressing metaphor for contemporary Hollywood and the way whole swaths of fans position themselves within it, Rey literally spends her days on Jakku raiding the picked-over husk of an Imperial cruiser before going home and eating beneath the comfort of an X-Wing while wearing a Rebel pilot's helmet, like she's putting on Star Wars pajamas before going to bed. Luke dreamed of seeing a world which he did not know much about. The promise of the unknown, the breaking of routine, was what felt exciting. But Rey knows what's out there. She's heard of Luke Skywalker, and of Han Solo, and of the Jedi, and literally lives amidst the ruins of their past adventures. She doesn't merely dream of leaving the nest and having an adventure, but leaving the nest and having a Star Wars adventure, which for her, like the audience, is a tangible reality she already knows about in great detail. That is not to say The Force Awakens does not attempt to or succeed in suturing us, but that the ordinary world that provides the anchor for suturing identification is not one of simple banality upon which the viewer can conflate their own daily routine. It is instead the specifically banal life of a Star Wars fan who dreams of becoming part of their favorite fantasy story. And this has a ripple effect all the way down the hero's journey checklist. The call to adventure isn't a call to something mysterious, but to go down a path we've seen others walk. Entering the unknown means boarding a famous spaceship, the Millennium Falcon, that we've heard about from legend and already know how to pilot. Not to mention the existence of the Force, the Jedi, the Sith, all of which are news to Luke Skywalker, but ancient history by the time Rey comes around. Her allies largely consist of Luke's allies. Leia, Han, Chewbacca, C-3PO, R2-D2, Lando Calrissian, Admiral Akbar, Nien Numb, and so on, all of whom return as legacy characters. The talisman that is the lightsaber has always had some level of legacy attached to it in Star Wars. Luke is, after all, first given the blade that belonged to his father. But for Rey, it can never completely become her talisman, since the goal of the first film is to get it back to Luke. And in the end, Rey's supreme ordeal is a direct repetition of Luke's, both in The Force Awakens when she helps destroy Starkiller Base, aka Death Star 3, and in The Rise of Skywalker when she squares off against Emperor Palpatine in the exact same moral dilemma the Sith Lord once posed to Luke in Return of the Jedi. As a result, while Rey's story ostensibly hits most of the broad strokes of Campbell's monomyth, she never really gets to have her own adventure. And the real question is, does she even want one? The range of possibilities created by a film's subjective framing says a lot about the work itself, but it also speaks to what the film thinks of its intended audience. The Force Awakens limits the subjective scope of itself and its sequels enormously by establishing Rey as a very particular kind of Star Wars fan stand-in, who wants to have an adventure they have already come to expect, implicitly connecting Rey and the viewer in a pact wherein they will get to have their own big Star Wars journey, but they won't get to have their own unique voyage of discovery, like Luke Skywalker, Jim Hawkins, or any other number of cinematic and literary precedents experienced in their own stories. And if the goal at the outset is to simply give fans what the filmmakers think they want, a Star Wars adventure where they, living vicariously through Rey, finally get to be the hero and have their obsessions and viewpoints reaffirmed within the canon, is there any room to tell an actual story? To surprise and move and shake the audience such that they might come out with a different understanding of the property than when they came in? If it can be achieved, as I would argue it largely is in Rian Johnson's much more confrontational The Last Jedi, can it be durable in the long term, given how quickly the franchise made a strategic retreat to safety? In October 2019, while promoting his new film The Irishman, Martin Scorsese stepped on the rake that is internet fanboys by suggesting he didn't view films in the Marvel Cinematic Universe as true cinema. In a New York Times editorial published on November 4th, Scorsese defended and elaborated on his views by explaining what he saw as the distinction between cinema as an art form and cinema as a theme park, defining the difference through what is absent in the Marvel formula. Quote, "What's not there is revelation, mystery, or genuine emotional danger. Nothing is at risk. The pictures are made to satisfy a specific set of demands, and they are designed as variations on a finite number of themes. They are sequels in name, but they are remakes in spirit. And everything in them is officially sanctioned because it can't really be any other way. That's the nature of modern film franchises. Market researched, audience tested, vetted, modified, re-vetted, and remodified until they're ready for consumption." End quote. What Scorsese describes sounds an awful lot like The Force Awakens, and the general tenor of the legacy film in general. Retreading old, well-worn steps, knowing that they are popular, but in so doing robbing the stories of the mystery and discovery that made them beloved in the first place. Luke Skywalker takes a risk when he leaves the moisture farm to train with Obi-Wan Kenobi. And so is George Lucas and 20th Century Fox and contemporary viewers, all of whom had no idea if this strange, ambitious blend of swashbuckling serials, samurai movies, and archetypal mythic stakes would come out to anything special. Is Rey or Disney or J.J. Abrams or modern Star Wars viewers really taking a risk in going off to live the adventure she has fantasized and trained for all her life? Yet even as risk-averse as The Force Awakens and The Rise of Skywalker appear when analyzing their narrative and identification mechanics, the films go one step further to tie their characters and viewers to the past in the relationship between legacy and successor characters. All legacy films feature literal or figurative parents, and most depict their children eventually growing beyond them. But the Star Wars sequel trilogy is unique in the sheer number of legacy characters Rey embraces as parents, and how little the story ultimately pushes her to let go of or move on from these figures by the end. I wish here to use a term coined by psychoanalyst Salman Akhtar in his book The Damaged Core, where he explores three fantasies related to unresolved separation individuation. One of these is the fantasy of a tether, and it helps illustrate both what is going on between Rey and her mini space parents within the text of Star Wars, and why the audience itself may be receptive to such storytelling. In explaining the tether and its related fantasies, Akhtar builds primarily on the work of Margaret Mahler, who theorizes the separation individuation stage of childhood development as a pre-Oedipal phase, occurring over the first 2 years of life, wherein an infant simultaneously develops a sense of self and forms boundaries that allow them to see their mother as an individual. The penultimate stage of this development, rapprochement, sees the child both desiring independence and fearing abandonment, wanting to explore further afield while maintaining proximity to the mother or guardian. A successful maturation through this stage results in the child developing a mental image of their mother, in which they can invest a sense of safety and confidence when physically distant, leading to a healthy sense of individual identity. Unresolved separation individuation occurs when this stage is not fully worked through, as Akhtar identifies in the clinical case studies he uses to describe the tether fantasy. Here, he looks at patients who found themselves stuck in the rapprochement phase, desiring both the freedom to explore and a tangible proximity to a source of safety. Jack Sullivan, for instance, imbued in Akhtar himself a sense of comfort and confidence, turning his psychoanalyst into a privileged object from whom he took both anxiety and pleasure by imagining walking away from. Quote, "The imagined tether clearly served as a defensive purpose insofar as it minimized the anxiety of separation while permitting him autonomous functioning." Similarly, Shane Sims expressed social and motoric inhibitions, including an anxiety about jogging. As Akhtar tells it, quote, "He constantly worried that he would end up getting too far away from his home, be unable to find his way back, and get hopefully lost. As a result, he only jogged around the block, never permitting himself to go too far away from his apartment building." The tether Akhtar here describes privileges an object, person, or space as safe, and creates a real or imagined radius outside of which one's sense of comfort diminishes and anxiety grows. One application of this framework would be to say that all of Hollywood, and a large swath of its audience, are going through an extended phase of unresolved separation individuation in relation to our long-running franchises, telling new stories within boundaries small and familiar enough that we perpetually feel tethered to the privileged object that is our childhood nostalgia. the entire phenomenon of the legacy film can be read through the lens of a tether fantasy, where we tell stories that give audiences the thrill of exploration or adventure, but only within a rigid, predetermined shape and distance built upon a continuity that we are not only familiar with, but may in fact be a formative narrative experience to many in the audience. The nature of fandom in and of itself can be an act of tethering, as we turn pieces of beloved media into privileged objects from which we draw strength and comfort. I, for instance, have a poster of Peter Jackson's Lord of the Rings, The Fellowship of the Ring, that I bought for my first apartment almost a decade ago, and has come with me through three subsequent moves to always occupy a place on the wall of my living space. This is a fandom-based tether, a totem of something I love, that makes me feel more comfortable when hanging on my wall. The nature of capitalism is such that it acts to scale up emotional connections like these into widespread industry practices. Instead of developing new intellectual property, why not dust off an old one fans are already tethered to, and invite them into the theater with the same promise of comfort that that poster on their wall has provided for so many years? Applied more specifically to the Star Wars sequel trilogy, the tether fantasy helps us understand the curious relationship between Rey and her many space parents over the course of the films, and provides another way of understanding how the Abrams installments in particular see the audience and their subjective desires. Rey's journey over the course of the trilogy boils down to a series of tethers between herself and different space daddies, Han, Luke, Lando, Palpatine, and space mommies, Leia, who are also, of course, tether points for an audience who grew up with these characters as figurative parents of their own. While the physical bodies of some of these space parents die, Rey is never made to completely release or move away from the safety of these tethers as characters in other legacy films, let alone the archetypal heroes of Campbell's monomyth, must eventually do. Rey's arc in The Force Awakens is all about finding a mythical, imagined space parent, the figure she longs for while living alone on Jakku, and each of the parental substitutes she encounters are all too eager to play the role. Han Solo offers her a permanent job aboard the Millennium Falcon when they arrive on Takodana, a mere 15 minutes of screen time after she and Solo first meet. Leia immediately treats Rey as a daughter, complete with maternal embraces. And Rey's ultimate end goal in the film is finding Luke Skywalker and reaching out to him in the hope that he may be the space daddy, literally or figuratively, she has been searching for all this time. Every major step Rey takes as a character is made with a tether securely tying her to the safety of a parent, and the moment when she has to step beyond the comforting distance of that tether never really arrives. If character-driven storytelling is, as it is often said, a balancing act between what a character wants and what a character needs, then The Force Awakens collapses both for Rey. She wants, more desperately than anything else, a parent, as established from her introduction. She gets multiple parental figures and continues to amass more, only losing Han Solo, one-third of her parental triad, in this film. And what she ultimately needs, the film seems to suggest, is the ultimate space daddy of Luke Skywalker, to whom she ventures at the end. There is no moment where Rey's want is challenged and a different need becomes clear. The search for a parent is, in the world of The Force Awakens, everything. Rian Johnson's follow-up, The Last Jedi, is quite different. It has been well covered by a plethora of writers how this film challenges Star Wars traditions and common fan assumptions. But for our purposes, most notable is the way Rey's unexpectedly difficult relationship with Luke challenges, and at points even severs, the tether Rey has to her space parents. Johnson resolves the cliffhanger from The Force Awakens, in which Rey extends her hand to Luke, offering him his old lightsaber, by having Luke nonchalantly toss the classic weapon over his shoulder and walk away without saying a word. It is clear he has no interest in teaching Rey, or venerating the Jedi, or being in any way the reassuring space daddy she so desperately wants. It is only in this second chapter that Rey's wants and needs get complicated, because while that yearning for a parent and related sense of belonging is made apparent throughout, including a memorable sequence in a cave on Ankh-To when Rey sees multiple copies of herself and no one else stretching out into infinity, the text of the film makes it clear that what she needs is a stronger, more robust, more independent sense of self, an identity that is not so firmly tied to Luke Skywalker or other relics of the past, but is reliant instead on her own strength, her own powers, and her own friends. In this way, Luke isn't the space daddy she wants, but he is the space daddy she needs, the one who pushes her to see a broader, more complicated portrait of the world and her place within it, a place beyond the confines of the tether she so urgently wants to build. A critical, much-debated moment in The Last Jedi comes after Rey and frenemy Kylo Ren kill the villainous Snoke and fight off his Praetorian guards. Kylo extends his hand to Rey, offering her a place at his side, and reveals that her parents were nobodies who sold her for drinking money. "You come from nothing," he tells Rey. "You are nothing." As painful as the revelation is for Rey to hear, it's another moment of want versus need coming into very necessary conflict. In a 2018 interview with Empire, Johnson explained that the moment intentionally mirrors the famous "No, I am your father" moment between Darth Vader and Luke Skywalker at the end of The Empire Strikes Back. Even though the reveals are quite different, Luke has a father standing right in front of him while Rey has no one at all, they are dramatically linked because of what those revelations mean to the characters hearing them. Darth Vader's admission does not work merely because it is a twist, but because, in Johnson's words, it is, quote, "the hardest possible thing that Luke, and hence the audience, could hear at that moment." Having the sheen of heroic glory ripped away from the visage of his imagined space daddy, only to be replaced with the darkness of Darth Vader, literally rips apart Luke's entire sense of self. The same goes for Rey when Kylo tells her that her parents were nobodies, robbing her of the possibility that she was wanted, that she was loved, and that she belonged. In both cases, these are key moments when the character's internal fantasy tethers are brutally severed. For Luke, at least, it's also the moment when he goes from seeing what he wants in the world to realizing what he needs, pushing him towards the moment in Return of the Jedi when he will be able to do what no other Jedi has done and defeat the Emperor through an act of peace and compassion. It should have been the same for Rey as well. The snapping of the tether and the moment when she realizes that what she wanted was always a fantasy should have been an irrevocable moment of profound character development and a key turning point in this new Star Wars saga. But The Last Jedi was, to put it mildly, a controversial film in certain fan circles. While the narrative that this backlash resulted in lost box office revenue or was even particularly widespread among the general audience is probably bunk, as Emily Vanderwerf of Vox points out, the hate campaign leveled against the film in certain circles was indeed quite real. The film was review-bombed by users on Rotten Tomatoes and Metacritic, widely derided by online right-wing media and internet trolls as too progressive for the sin of featuring non-white, non-male main characters, and screamed at for undermining popular fan theories developed after The Force Awakens, including the film issuing a declarative no to every piece of breathless speculation about Rey's parentage. And even though all available evidence seems to indicate this was not the overriding reaction to The Last Jedi among the general public, the film made $1.3 billion worldwide, it was widely acclaimed by critics, and scored just as highly on the CinemaScore metric as The Force Awakens and Rogue One, it seems Disney and J.J. Abrams took their marching orders from the trolls in producing the trilogy's final chapter, The Rise of Skywalker. To say this film walks back the developments of The Last Jedi would be a rancor-sized understatement. The Rise of Skywalker explicitly refutes every major theme from The Last Jedi and doubles down on tethering the characters and the audience to legacies of the past at every available turn. Leia returns, now training Rey as a Jedi and firmly ingrained as her mother figure. Lando Calrissian comes back as an additional space daddy for the group. Han Solo reappears from beyond the grave to set his son Kylo Ren down a better path in what is, and this is true, the only good scene in the movie. And when Luke inevitably reemerges as a Force ghost, it is to apologize to Rey for ever trying to push her outside her comfort zone. He walks out of a fire as Rey tries to burn her lightsaber, chastising her and his past self, and Rian Johnson, and every fan who enjoyed The Last Jedi, by telling her, "A Jedi's weapon deserves more respect." He admits he was ever wrong to doubt the wisdom of the Jedi Order, and tells her she was right about everything in their prior disagreements. In short, he promises to be a much better space daddy in death than he was in life. The tether, once broken, is now restored. The Rise of Skywalker collapses Rey's wants and needs together again, giving her an even bigger multitude of warm parental figures to lean on than ever before, and making her final act of heroism against Emperor Palpatine dependent on explicitly illustrated tethers to the entire history of the Jedi Order, and to the privileged totem that is the lightsaber. Both of them. Although her identity is nominally challenged when presented with the retcon that Sheev Palpatine is in fact her space grandpa, the revelation ultimately only reinforces what she wanted, and what she believed, all along, from the moment we meet her in The Force Awakens. That she is special, that her powers come from an important legacy, and that she did have a predetermined place in the universe reserved for her. The plot even goes out of its way to explain that, while Rey's space pappy was evil, her biological space mommy and space daddy were indeed kind and loving to the point of self-sacrifice, giving up their lives to make sure Rey had a chance to live. Rey is literally given everything she ever wanted, and the two major points of friction in the trilogy that challenged the foundational tethers of her identity, her combative relationship with Luke, and Kylo's revelation of her sad, unremarkable parentage, are not only restored, but reinforced many times over, never to be severed again. Thus, in the overarching story of the three films, Rey's identity is never significantly challenged. Indeed, what she is allowed to do is self-actualize on the exact fantasy path she, as the stand-in for Star Wars fanboys and fangirls the world over, might imagine in her dreams. Claim every major character from the classic films as her space parents, and then at the end adopt their identity as hers and conflate the two as a permanent piece of her final resolved self-image. Want and need never have to be rectified, because in the end her want is her need. She saves the day by embracing the Jedi lineage and grabbing extra lightsabers for maximum power. And when that is done, she joins want and need together seamlessly by declaring herself Rey Skywalker in front of Luke's boyhood homestead on Tatooine. This moment, where a random passerby demands to know Rey's full first and last name as though they are filling out a galactic census, has been roundly and deservingly mocked on the internet since the Rise of Skywalker's release, perhaps most famously in the following tweet by Chris Evangelista of Slash Film, which as of this writing has been retweeted 37,000 times and liked another 256,000. "I'm Rey." "Rey who?" Rey looks around for a moment, then smiles. Rey Star Wars. In a reply, Evangelista notes that this is no less stupid than the actual ending, and he is absolutely right. If Rey represents fan desire to go on their own Star Wars adventure, then what better way to end her journey than by having her adopt the last name synonymous with the franchise and literally make herself part of the family she always longed for? At its core, the hero's journey structure has always included an element of characters leaning upon mentors or legacy figures. Jim Hawkins with Long John Silver, Luke Skywalker with Ben Kenobi, and so on. But a key piece of the monomyth archetype is that the hero must ultimately move past these mentors to forge their own unique path and individual identity. No less an authority than Jedi Master Yoda himself reminds Luke of this at a key turning point in The Last Jedi, telling Luke that we are what they grow beyond. That is the burden of all masters. Yet Rey is denied this decoupling from her teachers, this essential severing of the umbilical cord between herself and her space daddies and space mommies, even after all those mentors have literally passed away. She gives herself the name Skywalker, in the spot where Luke once dreamed of the adventure that so completely gave shape to hers, and forever tethers herself to that legacy. She does not get to forge a bold new myth of her own, but merely continue as a footnote in one that came before. And for the fans sutured into this story through Rey, tethered like her to their nostalgia for the past, this is paramount to telling them it is okay, not just okay, but noble, essential, the ultimate endpoint of their journey, to claim the identity of their favorite childhood franchise within their own self-image, to conflate the two into one existence, perpetually stranded within the rapprochement phase of separation individuation, to embrace the franchise itself, the nostalgia itself, as their ultimate space daddy. Part 2. The Rise of Skywalker is to date the apex of this phenomenon, but it by no means appears to be the end point. In December 2019, Sony Pictures released the first trailer for Jason Reitman's Ghostbusters Afterlife, a legacy film sequel to his father Ivan's 1984 comedy classic. Even without seeing the full film, it could not be more abundantly clear from these 2.5 minutes of footage that Afterlife obsessively checks every box on the legacy film scorecard. The film follows two kids who move with their mother to a small town, only to discover their granddad was OG Ghostbuster Egon Spengler. Successor characters? Check. A new ghost hotspot is discovered beneath their home, repeating and revising old narrative concerns? Check. Where they also find all the classic equipment needed to bust those ghosts. Handover moments. Check. And by the end of the trailer, the kids are riding around town in Ecto-1, wearing the classic uniforms and proton packs, busting ghosts in the middle of Main Street. Shift in narrative impetus to successor characters. Check. Although not revealed in the trailer, it has also been confirmed that all surviving stars of the original film, minus Rick Moranis, are back to reprise their roles. So, legacy characters, that's also a check. The trailer is so densely awash in reverent, slack-jawed nostalgia for the majesty of the Ghostbusters property that it forgets to make a single joke, and features an aesthetic palette less reminiscent of the New York set original films and more in line with the nostalgic veneration contemporary productions like It and Super 8 have imbued the 1980s, the period when grown-up Ghostbusters fans would have first seen the films as children. Unlike The Force Awakens, or Jurassic World, or Terminator Genesis, Ghostbusters Afterlife supplants nostalgia for the parent property with nostalgia for nostalgia itself, a gnarled Ouroboros of sentimental navel-gazing, greedily gorging upon its own tail until one cannot tell the creature's front from its end. The causality that led to this misshapen knot of masturbatory legacy porn is not in any way in question. The commercial failure of and abject onslaught of negative fan reaction to Paul Feig's 2016 Ghostbusters reboot is, as Suzanne Scott puts it, reflective of what happens when a fanboy auteur is perceived as taking too transformative an approach. Ghostbusters 2016, or Ghostbusters Answer the Call as it was rechristened for home video, is notably not a legacy film, eschewing the continuity of the original Ivan Reitman installments and featuring an all-female lead cast who discover the existence of ghosts, make the equipment, and save the day without the help of legacy characters from earlier entries. While Feig and his cast routinely proclaimed their fanish adoration of the 1984 original film, many fans of the franchise viewed the gender-swapping of the film's protagonists as antithetical to an authentic fan appreciation of the franchise. This grotesque backlash, which, like the reaction to The Last Jedi, was fueled in no small part by sexism and racism, including a campaign to harass star Leslie Jones off social media, a grim portent of what awaited Kelly Marie Tran less than 2 years later when trolls forced her off Instagram after The Last Jedi, is again, according to Scott, a prime example of the limits of fanboy auteur identity. Given Feig's perceived failure to affirmationally align his reboot with what were conceived to be the core canonical facets of the original, any and all promotional insistence on his own fan identity was functionally meaningless. Though textually different than its legacy film contemporaries, Ghostbusters Answer the Call tried to ride the same 30-year cycle wave of nostalgia for 80s Hollywood properties. But in attempting to do so in a more adventurous, outside-the-box manner, it was viciously slapped down by existing fans. They did not want something new, something that would tell them their specific experience with this media object was not the be-all, end-all of that object's existence in the world. They wanted something old, something comforting. They wanted their space daddy. And in the end, is it possible to more affirmationally align one sequel than by putting the original director's son in the captain's chair, bringing back all but one living cast member, slathering every inch of the marketing in bright blinking signals of unbridled nostalgic devotion, and just for good measure, casting exactly one adult woman in the main cast, world-class performer Carrie Coon, only to relegate her to the thankless role of the mom? None of this is to say that all legacy films are as pathetically simpering as Ghostbusters Afterlife or fundamentally useless as The Rise of Skywalker. Like any generic movement, there are examples that subvert the trend and ones that rise above it. Denis Villeneuve's Blade Runner 2049 and Mike Flanagan's Dr. Sleep are both subversive legacy sequels that explicitly play with the tethering dynamics between parents and children described earlier. In Blade Runner 2049, Ryan Gosling's K is an android police officer who, in the course of an investigation, comes to believe he might be the part-human child of Harrison Ford's returning legacy character Rick Deckard. K is positioned as a figurative child longing for the embrace of a parent, but his search ultimately proves to be a red herring when he discovers Deckard's actual child and is forced to reckon with the truth that he is, indeed, an artificial creation. This allows the film's third act to move beyond the search for a parent or desire to fulfill another's legacy, as Kay's ultimate heroic deed is to selflessly sacrifice himself so Deckard and his daughter may be reunited. In this way, his artificial life is granted genuine human meaning by learning to go beyond his own subjectivity and act for the good of others, something a mere android, an automaton following in footsteps preordained by figures from the past, would not be able to achieve. Dr. Sleep, meanwhile, is a fascinating work that, while nominally based on Stephen King's 2013 novel of the same name, also serves as a sequel to Stanley Kubrick's adaptation of The Shining from 1980, and even adapts portions of King's 1977 novel left out of the Kubrick film. In assimilating these various, frequently divergent sources, Dr. Sleep becomes a particularly subversive legacy film, leveraging our ingrained cultural memory of Kubrick's horror masterpiece to connect our minds with that of protagonist Dan Torrance, who as an adult still reels from his childhood trauma at the Overlook Hotel. Dr. Sleep is, to my knowledge, the only legacy film that is actively concerned with avoiding the specter of the past, as Dan's greatest fear is that he might follow in the steps of his abusive, alcoholic father. Taking seriously the themes of addiction and domestic abuse heavy in King's work, but left as a haunting implication in Kubrick's film, Dr. Sleep tells a story about a child learning to rise above and move beyond his own dark legacy. When the film finally returns to the abandoned Overlook Hotel in the third act, it is not merely as an excuse to nostalgically walk in well-worn steps, but to offer Dan a chance to prove that, in similar circumstances, he can be more than his father ever was. His legacy makes him who he is, but it does not define the limits of his character or capacity for growth. Unlike Ray, Dan has the power to write his own story. Ryan Coogler's Creed, meanwhile, is perhaps the most sterling example of a straightforward legacy film, following all the core tenets of such sequels, yet in a vastly smarter, more critically thoughtful fashion. Adonis Creed is a successor character who takes the baton from legacy icon Rocky Balboa, but Creed's desire to build his legacy in the shadow of his infamous father Apollo is critically interrogated throughout. If cinema must involve risk, as Martin Scorsese insists, then Creed absolutely fits the bill. It takes some very big, bold swings in transforming the saga of Rocky Balboa, a white working-class everyman who, in going from the bottom to the top, fulfills our classic cultural perception of the American dream, into a deeply felt parable about the legacy of black men in America growing up without fathers, and what that absence can do to a person's sense of self-worth and legitimacy. At the film's climax, when Adonis is pushed against the wall by opponent Ricky Conlan, Rocky tries to stop the fight, concerned for his protege's health. Adonis refuses, insisting that he has to prove it. "Prove what?" Rocky asks. Without missing a beat, Creed replies, "That I'm not a mistake." It's been 5 years since Creed came out, but I can remember the collective intake of breath that swept the packed opening night auditorium when Michael B. Jordan delivered that line, like it was yesterday. Creed is brimming with obvious love for what Sylvester Stallone and company achieved in the original Rocky films, but it has very little interest in reassuring us of the supremacy of our shared nostalgia for the series. Like Ray, Owen Grady, Sam Flynn, or any of the other literal or figurative children of the 2010s legacy sequels, Adonis initially steps into his parents' shoes to feel the safe, comfortable tether they confer. Unlike those characters, or the films they belong to, Adonis and Creed each reach a place of acknowledging the painful insecurity underlying that need to walk in a forebearer's steps. And when that acknowledgement is made, when Adonis admits his fear that he might be a mistake, It knocks the wind right out of the viewer. So deftly does it diagnose a cultural pathology underlying much of the media we now consume. That it arrives at this point by exploring the lived reality of a racial demographic who are routinely denied humanity and interiority in American culture, media, and film, including several legacy sequels targeted by fans for ever daring to venture outside the white male archetype, makes that final punch all the more poignant. For now, though, films like Creed, Dr. Sleep, and Blade Runner 2049, which think critically about the nature of legacy rather than merely celebrating it, are the exception, not the rule. We have reached a point, symbolized most strongly by the intra-franchise response of The Rise of Skywalker to The Last Jedi, where the dominant pathology of the contemporary franchise legacy film can perhaps best be summarized by this exasperated passage from Roger Ebert's 2009 review of Kyle Newman's Fanboys, a movie about a group of friends whose identities are so wrapped up in fandom that when one of them becomes terminally ill, they drive across the country to break into Skywalker Ranch and make sure he can see the Phantom Menace early. Ebert writes, "A lot of fans are basically fans of fandom itself. It's all about them. They have mastered the Star Wars or Star Trek universes or whatever, but their objects of veneration are useful mainly as a backdrop to their own devotion. Anyone who would camp out in a tent on the sidewalk for weeks in order to be first in line for a movie is more into camping on the sidewalk than movies. Extreme fandom may serve as a security blanket for the socially inept who use its extreme structure as a substitute for social skills. If you are Luke Skywalker, and she is Princess Leia, you already know what to say to each other, which is so much safer than having to ad-lib it. Your fanish obsession is your beard. If you know absolutely all the trivia about your cubbyhole of pop culture, it saves you from having to know anything about anything else. That's why it's excruciatingly boring to talk to such people. They're always asking you questions they know the answers to." They're always asking you questions they know the answers to. If that doesn't describe the current shape and character of the Hollywood legacy sequel, then I don't know what does.